Bonjour, welcome. My name is Marie-Laure Turo. I've worked for OpenAI for over a year. I run sales, so you're not going to hear too much about me. What I wanted to do today is, before I hand over to our CTO, is just to give you a brief overview of who we are and where we came from, because I'm not quite sure a lot of you have heard about us. So, coming to this, I just want to give you a brief overview of OpenAI. OpenAI was founded, it's 5 years old company, basically. It was founded in 2015 by four engineers in the north of France, Lille, where our headquarters. We also have offices in Paris and Tokyo. Basically, we do have offices where we have consequent customer base. We do have customers in Japan, so therefore, and partners, so therefore, we do support customer directly from Japan. One of our founder of OpenAI is based out of Tokyo. OpenAI is a privately owned company by two private investors and also by an investor from the north of France, the region. What it is interesting to note about OpenAI is that we've been recently recognized part of the French tech, and also we've been selected as one of the startups to follow up very closely. So I'm not going to say that to you, but you know better than I do that the storage world is a very, very, very populated market with a lot of potential solutions. So what I do recognize in OpenAI is that in less than 5 years, the company has grown to have roughly nearly 40 customers, ranging from, for the French audience, Le CEA, ICM, which is the, in English, I think it's spine, voilà, DCL, l'Institut d'Amois-les-Pinières. So ranging from, big organizations like the CEA, ICM, Kairos, to other big organizations more in the, industry world like Dailymotion. So our range of customer today is quite impressive for a small startup like ours. It's primarily and mainly a very techie-driven organization. There are very few people like me. It's more people like Michael or Jean-François or like John say Jean-Françoise. Not yet. So basically, yeah, we do have customers ranging from very small volume solution to large solution running like 40 petabyte of data in production. So what it is we want to provide and what it is that we do that make us different from others. What they aimed at when they built the company was to provide a very performant open source object storage solution who would be capable to meet the needs of customer working in HPC and big data world. So if you have one thing to remember about OpenAI is obviously the open source part, which is quite important, but also the fact, and Jean-François will explain that the way our technology has been thought of and developed make it different. At the core of the technology, the DNA of OpenAI is really object-oriented and to handle, large volume of data. So we are hoping to become, I mean, we all live in a very, very data-centric world. Recently I was looking at some statistics and the number of data that is generated on a daily basis is just, flabbergasted. So I think we are still there for quite a long time. So that's it, basically. I don't have much to say except that, this is a French company, French startup. We are very happy to partner with HDF. Mind you, when the partner is based in a city called Champagne, for a French company, it can only mean success. So I'm wishing you a very good 2 days, and I hope that actually, we will have a very successful 2 days. So I'll hand over to Jean-François. Bonjour, François.
Just take the mic. So I'm Jean-François, nice to meet you all, CTO and founder of the company, and sorry for this, but I recognize now that the message is slightly different from what we probably have for today, because at OpenIO especially, we focus mostly on one thing, is that we call the TCO, probably something that you are used to if you have to manage a platform to operate it with a non-infinite budget. And that's where it becomes important to talk about it. And especially something that you are probably used to. If you operate a platform, you probably have one solution coming from the right side and another solution coming from the left side. That's probably that you manage yourself, your life cycle, your data life cycle between hot, mutable, and high performance storage for the hot data. And then you archive it when you are talking about the old, colder, immutable data that you keep for long-term retention. And I'm probably sure that you have tape solution and not yet an object storage one, because we are in the context of HDF5 talking about its introduction in the landscape today. Today we are here to talk about this, the object storage possibility in that landscape, what it brings to you, how it has been integrated into HDF5 and how it can be useful for a typical use case in your situation. So what is object storage? In fact, it is just actually just a way. It is a simple way, very simple way to store a lot of immutable data and accompanying metadata, providing high parallelism. I don't understand there high concurrency on each file, but a heavy parallelism level that allows you plenty of concurrent access to the same file in read fashion, especially. On a data set that is completely online all the time, but in the same time, it is cloud-oriented, made on protocols that you are not the most familiar with, I think, in terms of HPC, HTTP, HTTP, HTTPS, REST, everything that John presented to you is something that is the world I come from. I'm not from HPC at the origin, but I come from that kind of the product. The standards that we face in that kind of industry, you know them for sure, S3 coming from AWS, Swift coming from OpenStack. The one is commercial and has a copyright on it. The other one is more open, but it is less famous in the world. But meanwhile, you have to implement both if you want to say that you are an object storage that is acceptable on the marketplace. That's fine, but meanwhile, and John explained that very well in his presentation, this is both as standards S3 and Swift in the cloud world, but not that much in HPC, while HDF5 and MPIO are. You understood that HDFI has not been designed in the origin to work. It has been made for POSIX accesses and not for cloud-based access where you push each file once at once entirely. You do not update, but you replace the objects. And in HPC, you also pay very often to huge, and I consider huge, and mutable dataset, large matrices that where you change just a little place. But you also face exactly the same problem that we try to solve for the cloud world. It is that you need a TCO that is lower because you already face more and more and more data, and you already observe an aging life cycle of the data, and you are probably interested, and we are sure about that, a better way to achieve that lower management cost. So how can such a solution integrate into into a world that requires mutable data sets, either being placed behind the hot tier that you will still use, a parallel file system that you will always require for bursts at the output of the experiments, or independently with the help of a side orchestrator. And this is the way that we choose when integrating with Kita. Kita will be necessary whatever you do because you have to transform the mutability of your of the data in your application into the immutability of the storage that we provide. So Kita will be the middleware that you will need for that, and we will work not behind the hot storage. It could be an way to do that. I imagine plugging behind Lustre could be a possibility, but we prefer relying on an orchestrator. HDF5 will do the job. Do you hear me? Okay. HDF5 will do the job, for instance, and play the role of the orchestrator that we need. So an object store is fine, okay, but why OpenIO? And sorry for the marketing polish of the slide. It denotes from the rest of the day for sure, but no, it's important. There are very specific messages in the solution in the slide that explain why the solution is different. Especially when you compare to MinIO, when you compare to Ceph, however, most of them rely on a static placement algorithm on its design. Oh, okay. So we do not want that, because we know by experience that the versatility of the platform can be huge with hardware that is heavily heterogeneous. You can have all the devices, new hardware, with very various performance, capacities, densities. And you are often concerned with hardware problems that you want to decommission the hardware, move the data at another place, and you do not want the static placement algorithm in that kind of situation, just because it will involve huge data movements, topologies changes, and you want to control everything, and especially the rhythm of the operation. You do not want to rebalance the cluster when the algorithm tells you to do, but when the business tells that you are able to do that. You do not want to have an impact on the business, and the business is what matters for you. You do not want to trouble the boundaries of the platform just because data migration is pending on the because of operation task. So instead of relying on a static placement algorithm, we introduce two things that are very different. Instead of knowing the location of an object based on its name, we choose a new location when we create it, and we keep the location in a data structure to remember the place. We keep track of the objects. This gives us an advantage in terms of flexibility when you operate the platform, so that you can much more easily stretch it, shrink it, depending on the needs. If you want to decommission the platform, just vacuum that drive, move the data somewhere else when you are able to do that, between two experiments, for example, and then continue to work with the restricted or stretched platform. The solution from the very beginning has been made open source, and that's why it's important. We are just a company. Company exist, get acquired, however, but the solution will always exist, and you will never depend on the license, on the subscription of the solution, or on the company. You can install it, run it by yourself if you want. We have nothing to hide. It's up to you. Of course, we would be very happy to sell you something, especially a subscription, but this is not mandatory at all. How did we do to integrate both solutions? That's the most important. You've seen the presentation. I won't elaborate much more on this. What's more interesting to give you how we did? Here is the typical architecture that John presented to you on how Kita is made, is organized, or the system is organized, with the client talking to a load balancer that will choose an available service node that will spread the load and scatter gather the communication across the data nodes. that will talk to a persistence backend. Would it have partitions or not? When talking to S3, you talk to the S3 endpoint of the same region, and that's it. OpenIO is made in a very similar way, where you have your client talking to a load balancer to find a S3 compatible gateway, providing the kind of persistence backend that you have here. Internally, we do not rely on that kind of load balancing or to a static placement algorithm, but we make a call to the load balancing part or the directory part to choose a place or to remember it. And when we want to create an object, we pull locations, we push the object, we commit it in the directory, and that's it. When you want to fetch an object, you just ask the directory, get the location, and then fetch the object. Very similar way to design the solution. And the very first step when we tried to integrate both solutions was not efficient but functional. What did we do? Just assimilate the persistence backend, the endpoint, to the load balancing endpoints of both solutions. We had a vanilla out-of-the-box integration of both solutions, and it just works like this, not with the best results, and that's why a second step has been necessary. So what did we have when we did this? Many redundant patterns between both solutions, load balancing, caching, sharding, however, it was hard at the end to understand the path that was taken by the data and what was cached where. I mean, in my opinion, we lack control when we do this. We also had a huge bandwidth usage because you have an amplification factor. As soon as you get through a gateway or load balancer, you have the bandwidth coming in, coming out, and if you can do another way, it's probably preferable, because that's also a resource that is not for free. You are probably in your daily job used to very fast bandwidth with 10, 40, 100 gigs, I don't know, on each host, but it is not always the case, and sometimes this is the resources that can lack in your data center. We also had two autonomous clusters. Kita, if I come here, has been initially deployed for Kubernetes or Docker-style clusters, while we mostly play on bare metal when and that we deploy with Ansible, ROS, Facebook, etc. So two ways to deploy the solution. And at OpenIO, we are a strongly stateful data bound, and we are not made that much to stretch instantly based on the demand, because we are just storing data. While on Kita, it was not the case, and then not depending, but relying on volatile way to deploy the load. So it was acceptable, but we decided to do another way, to do another integration step. And this is what we arrived to. First, we, with John, decided to register all the, to deploy all the services not in the Kubernetes, not in the Docker or Swarm, whatever, solution, to deploy everything on the same platform that OpenIO runs on. Doing this, you avoid at least the management task for the deployment itself. You remove one stack, the one for the system, for the Kubernetes, for example, for instance. We also decided to register all the nodes that were subject to load balancing into the load balancer of OpenIO. Give them a score, register them, make the discovery happen on that services, so that you can use the load balancer to, the same way you find an acceptable location to store the data, find the services that is the most suitable to serve the request. You do this, so the client asks the load balancer good services. The load balancer relies on the information of the functions, but instead of passing through the load balancer, we ask him a redirection to the service node. It adds a latency, but not a bandwidth consumption. So it helps save a lot of gigabytes on the platform that we use to test just doing this. Next step, we do not change anything. This is the job of Kita. But what has been very interesting is that instead of crossing the network between the data node that is responsible to store the data and the S3 endpoint, we just deploy it locally. So that you also save a network access with just a local host one. And as a second step, it also saves plenty of latency because you are working locally, it works very well like this. And you also save plenty of actual network boundaries because localhost is way faster than this. We do exactly the same with the metadata. We have a local cache into OpenIO to be much, much faster into all the communication toward the directory so that we can save a lot of latency there. And then do those exactly what we did into OpenIO, pull the best location of the service and save actually the data. When we deploy everything, we just set up what I call a deployment unit, a stack of services that are quite independent but deploy at the same time. When you deploy a host in the solution, you deploy that little silo, a service node, a data node to participate to the GitHub part of the stack, and then a S3 gateway and the ROI services in addition to a few directory services to participate to the OpenIO ROI. And that's it. The benefits that you can have there, and I promise I will be quick because I see that you are hungry, all of you. I'm nearly the last person that separate you from the lunch. What we get first, optimized performance. Yes, we made strong efforts and it is not finished yet on the pragmatism and the parsimony in the resource consumption. Sorry. Latency, bandwidth, make them... I heard that it was something very inspected. You take a lot of effort to be sure that the solution that you will deploy will fit the IO requirements in terms of latency bandwidth, and that's exactly the kind of topic for us, because even in the cloud world, this is something that you have to take care of, just because they have exactly the same needs that you can have, but with probably much lower budget. So the logic that we had when we designed the solution is probably good for any use case. And just because we tightly coupled both architectures, deploying at the same place, getting the benefits from local deployments, local communication, etc., etc. I don't remember, I did not ask that many improvements and performance tuning in any of those solutions. It was just mostly a deployment effort and that much like this. The TCO in itself is also improved, and that's the most important part of the presentation, just because you have less hardware, less management cost for that hardware, less technical stack that you do not have to keep people trained to that kind of hardware. I mean, managing a Kubernetes cluster is not that simple, and if you already tried that, you are probably well aware of that. And integrating both management cycles will help you also to reduce the cost of updating the platform, etc. That's something obvious in my opinion. The whole stack is open source. You can still have it whatever you decide regarding the company. Would you stop to have any subscription? I mean, I care, but that's the game, and you will still have the sovereignty on your data, on your site, on premises. And we also make the effort to increase the overall scalability of the solution, because we are heavily data-bound, and as long as you deploy OpenIO, the OpenIO part of the stack, you are ready to benefit from the available resources to also transfer the data. Kita is more RAM-consuming, where we are more network and capacity consuming. So if you have hardware that is mixed in between both requirements, that's a good way to squeeze all the capacity of any hardware that you have. Just deploy the whole stack everywhere and benefit from every bit of performance that is on the platform. And just to finish, to summarize, there is just a little demo if you want after that. I just try to imagine what could be the journey of a scientist that could visit one facility like here, the one here. the person comes, I try to be inclusive enough, and sorry for that, just two genders for today. The person comes, plugs the experiments on the run of the synchrotron. The data are generated, dumped on the tape because you do not want to lose them. I guess that preliminary validation and also to check if it is necessary to start again, I don't know. And after a few weeks, that's what I imagine, probably it is longer than this, probably it is shorter, I don't know for sure, that person comes back to his or her university with a pile of DVD with all the data on it. We've seen that it is much faster to take the snowball case. Okay. So exactly the same, but and the data is then flushed from the fast buffer, the whatever burst buffer, parallel file system, however, it has to be flushed because that buffer costs a lot. But what I can imagine if I have a solution like an object store in the same architecture, the beginning starts exactly the same. The scientist comes, the test happens, the data is dumped. But what happens there is not a copy on the tape, but a copy on a private cloud. You can still have a tape in it, but I prefer imagine it as a secondary tier into the object store itself. If you, the kind of solution like OpenIO allows you to manage this, internal storage policies that say, oh, all data, I move it on the, this is, if you know the Amazon S3 lifecycle extension that allows that, OpenIO implements it, and you can see the tape library as a Glacier, Amazon Glacier implementation. Then the scientist has just the preliminary validation on the cloud, and you can use all the example of John. And then, in my opinion, if the experimentation is good, you can immediately leave because you still have the credentials to the cloud, and I can easily imagine keeping the access to a private cloud that will be managed by yourself. And I think it's something that is more and more common in your understanding of the platform. So what happens at the end, if the data stays shorter on the fast buffer, it is probably too quick as a conclusion, but the buffer can be smaller, and that's good because it is very expensive. And if you can make it smaller, you can maybe make it more powerful, and it's up to you to use that. And from my understanding also, it's better to get back with credential to a cloud than a pile of a Blu-ray DVD. But this is just for me. So, if you have...
Do you want to take questions now?
Oh, sorry. If you have any question.
In your last SCI, how does it fit your write column when your green line is generating half a petabyte per day?
Per day? No, but you can. I do not say this is the only kind of solution that is available. It can remain also in the just on the cloud. If you want to flush it, you are still allowed to dump it on a Blu-ray DVD. I mean, this is not the only way to do. You know.
I think this is very close to the right hand side is what we would like to have. But you still have to keep the data for 10 years.
But in my
what you can't do is you can't take half a petabyte away on DVDs. You need a truck.
For half a bit, but probably on tapes, just a smaller truck. Now, if you want to bring back a half a petabyte or dozens, I don't know, petabytes.
Yeah,
there's a bigger version of the snowball.
The snowball truck. But
our users don't have that kind of.
Sure. But we have many. Not many demands, but we feel an interest for an integration of the tape as a very slow tier behind the object store with an orchestrator acting in the object store itself because people have tens or sometimes hundreds of petabytes and just want to offload, and even the object store becomes too expensive for them. And then they can move and relocate tape libraries. Some people do, sometimes.
Okay, in the interest of lunch, we do the demo. Do you want to speak?
basically this is the John demo.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, just to show it works.
So
you could then drop that.
Okay.
And you are on HDMI.
Yes.
So I've already used Jupyter made by John. Only it talk on the on my laptop because I don't have access to my test cluster. It's a VPN issue. So it would be a net fast as Amazon. Sorry. The file from our H2 gateway. So we extract the small part of data. This way. This will be in cache. And this part is more longer because it extracts all the chunk. So when you have a tug, there are no parallel exam made. So it works.